Good morning and welcome to Citizenship. I hope you had a great week last week starting to design your own country. I hope you had a great creative time thinking about what your flag will look like, your motto, and all the practical details like where your country will be, how you chose the name, what your citizens will be called. This week and today, I'm going to introduce the four different things that I'd like you to add this week. Where there's a fifth lesson, by the way, on the timetable, I'd like to use that time to keep on adding to what you've already got there. Hopefully this will be an enjoyable piece. You can think about new things to tweak and add, and so you can make your country exactly as you'd like it. Being able to explain, of course, all the decisions that you've made, because that's what rulers have to do. That's what governors of countries have to do. And balancing up everybody's needs. And this week, I'm going to increase the challenge to stretch you from doing a good piece of work to a better piece of work. So there's at least two more creative tasks. There's at least two more tasks around the theme of governance and showing off all of the knowledge that you have there. So you will by now be having, I reckon, your big sheet of flip chart paper that's now got more things on it. I've now put, for example, my flag. I folded it up and stapled it to this corner. So all of these different bits of information, however you present them, start to add them to your big piece of flip chart paper. Today, please forgive the misprint on the handout. I got so excited making them that I didn't read through that one properly. But just think about, what is your country's national dish going to be? The reason that I'm asking you that is not just for interest's sake, but for many, many, many cultures, a sense of national identity, which is part of the citizenship curriculum, a sense of national identity comes from including a national dish. And so what would yours be and what would the reason be? What I would like, please, is for you to be able to draw it. And just do the best of your ability. I will set the bar nice and low with my drawing skills. So you need to be able to draw it and explain the reason that you're choosing this as your national dish. Have you got any idea of what my national dish might be? I thought not from the quality of my artistic work. But look, I've put the effort in, so whatever you're able to do, I will appreciate your effort. For me, it's an all-day breakfast or mixed grill type thing. Oh, complete with a fruit salad, of course. And that's the national dish because it suits my body in terms of my nutritional needs. So really, my type of governance is getting more and more like a dictatorship because I'm expecting my citizens to join in with what suits me. And there are many examples across the world of dictatorship-style governance. So anyway, that's today's task, to have a think about a good reason, and I've given you a really simple possibility of a reason. Now, it could be where your country is based. So, for example, if you remember, with my working example, Jayland used to be called the Isle of Wight, and all around the Isle of Wight is oceans, and so perhaps a more reasonable, a more logical dish for Jayland would be something like fish and chips or Admiral Pie or one of those kind of meals. So have a think about, is it to your taste? Is it to do with the surroundings? Is it to do with your economy, what you can produce? And think about what your national dish will be. That's for Monday. Now, moving on to Tuesday, I'd like to have a little think about this. And remember, each day, it's about adding something so that this big piece of flip chart paper will get filled with lots of different ideas. On Tuesday, remember last week, I asked what your citizens' rights and responsibilities would be. Well, they're not the only people who will have rights and responsibilities. What about your leadership? So whoever it is that you've chosen to rule your country, what will their rights be? For example, do they have security where they live? If you were to walk down a street, you can't just walk into that street. There's armed police keeping the Prime Minister safe all the time. You can't just walk into the grounds of Buckingham Palace. There's people keeping the Queen safe. In other countries, there's different levels of security. So what will the rights of your rulers be? Do they have free speech or are they kept in check? Remember, in Britain, we have what's called a constitutional monarchy, which means that the monarch and the government keep each other accountable. So using that technical vocab, going back to that handout from a couple of weeks ago about the tribes on the island, that activity, the story, and thinking through what rights do your rulers have and what are their promises to their citizens. And I'd like a charter of 5 key promises that your citizens will have from their rulers. In Jayland, for example, one of my promises will be that there will be no lack of opportunity for activity. That's different from no unemployment, but for me, one thing that will be important in my country is the opportunity to volunteer, the opportunity to give something to the nation, and for it to run in a hopefully more selfless way. At least that's my ideology for my country. I wonder if you can think about this as well on Tuesday. Does your ruler interact with the citizens much? Maybe they come and visit for special occasions. Maybe they don't. Look, if you're the kind of person, if you're running a nation and you're a very private person, you might say that I want nothing to do face to face with my citizens. I want an ivory tower where I can just stand or sit or be and just not get involved. In some nations, the leader does stay very, very hidden. In other nations, they're very visible. So that's something to consider on Tuesday. And again, what are your reasons for this? And please, if you can, link this back to, for a best piece of work, link this back to your style of governance, to use those technical words. On the third day that you work on this, I would like you to add a national anthem. Most, if not all, nations have a national anthem. And this, a bit like the national dish that we spoke of on the first day, goes towards having a sense of identity. No other countries in the world, apart from Commonwealth ones, shares our national anthem. No other countries share the Stars and Stripes as their national anthem. So, I wonder, what will your country's national anthem be? What will the lyrics be? What will the tune be? Now, if you're really musical, you could write a new tune, and I'd love to hear some of these. And if you want, if you feel up to it, maybe we can perform some of these back in the centre. But for now, what will the lyrics be? I want at least one verse written out. What will the tune be? If you want to compose one, you can. If you want to use an established tune, you can. If you are that way inclined creatively, there's nothing stopping you having a rap as your national anthem that you have written. So I want, for this, one verse to state what the tune is and some notes about what's inspired your song in order to join in, to be accountable, so I'm not just setting you work in theory. I've written one. Which I've just called the Jayland National Anthem. It's got some of my core values in here about people being able to be productive, people being able to belong, being able to give to society, and just that's a really nice country, really, because national anthems tend to be about saying we're the best. Moving on the fourth day of fresh material, have a think about this. Criminal justice. Now, we looked at this a few weeks back in that first batch of work that I sent home, didn't we? And now this week, I'd like to ask you the following questions. Who enforces the law? For example, here in the UK, here in Britain, we have the police service, which was set up initially to be very community-ish, and nowadays it's a specialist job. But there are also some special constables that are not paid and they join in. The military help a bit in enforcing the law in emergencies. So if things get really busy, they will join in. So who enforces the law and how? Remember, there was that bit of work that we did a few weeks back again about the different aims of punishment. So what kind of ways will the law get enforced? In some countries, the death penalty still exists, and it's still a bit of a spectator thing going on. In some countries, it's prisons, it's fines. So who enforces the law and how? Oh, and also, how are you going to fund the people who enforce the law? If you remember that activity about the mystery country a few weeks back, in Britain, the army used to enforce all the laws. There was no special police service, and they could do whatever they want, and they kind of lived off their fines. And in some countries, that is still the case, that the police live off their fines. There are some private companies that fine people who drop litter, and that's how they get their income. And then I'd like you to think carefully about five key laws for your country. You might think that there are lots of important laws, but if I can narrow it down, what are the five key laws that your country would have? And for each one, I'd like to hear, please, what's the consequence of breaking them? So, the last extra bit to add for this week, at least, is five key laws, and for each of them, what is the consequence for breaking them? So I hope you have a great varied week, adding fresh stuff to your Design a Country piece of work. And I look forward to seeing you again, or I'm not, I'm seeing a camera, but for you to see me again next week for the next bit of additional stuff to make this a brilliant piece of work. Have a lovely, productive and creative time.